नमस्ते स्टूडेंट्स, माय नेम इज जेविंस डॉक्टर नीरज धोलिया, फैकल्टी ऑफ एग्रीकल्चर एंड वेटरनरी साइंस, ज्योति विद्यापीठ, वुमेन्स यूनिवर्सिटी जयपुर। सो टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस अबाउट द प्रीवियस एक्सपीरियंस एंड द बिहेवियर। सो व्हाट इज द इन्फ्लुएंस ऑफ द प्रीवियस एक्सपीरियंस ऑन द बिहेवियर? सो दिस इज ऑल्सो नोन एज द लर्न्ड बिहेवियर्स। Learn means you have taken the experience and that affect your behavior, reflects in your behavior. Okay, so in general, a learned behavior is one that an organism develop as a result of experience. Okay, so when you get the experience of something, you have the your behavior will change and you behave like which reflects that experience in your behavior. So the learned behavior in contrast with the innate behaviors, which are genetically controlled and performed without any prior experience or training. So some behaviors have both learned and innate components, like the imprinting. There are many type of the learned behaviors. For example, the zebra finches are genetically programmed to learn a song, but the song they sing depends on what they have hear from their father. So it have both the component. One is the innate component and another is the learned component. So there are many types of the experiences, or we can say the learned behaviors, and we will study one by one. So first one is the habituation. So what is the habituation? Means it is a very simple form of the learned behavior, which an animal stops responding in a stimulus or cue after a period of repeated exposure. So this is a form of non-associative learning, and that means the stimulus is not linked with any punishment or reward. So the stimuli is there, but it is not associated with any reward or any harm, any punishment. So that type of stimuli, the animal that get habituate towards that stimuli. So next one is the imprinting. So before starting the imprinting, we have one example of the habituation. Okay, so the dogs typically sound an alarm call when threatened by a predator, and at first they will give this alarm call in response to hearing human steps, which indicate the presence of a large and potentially hungry animal. So however, the dog gradually become habituated to the sound of human footsteps, as they repeatedly experience the sound without anything bad happening. So eventually they stop giving the alarm call in response to footsteps. So in this example, the habituation is specific to the sound of human footsteps, as the animals still respond to the sounds of the potential predators. Next one is the imprinting. So imprinting is a simple and highly specific type of learning behavior that occurs at a particular age, or it have a crucial time to develop the imprinting. Okay, so for example, the ducks and the geese, in initial time when the eggs are hatched, whatever the things they find around them, they start imprint to that, or they consider that object as their parents. So when they hatch, the eggs are hatched, they imprint on the first adult animal they see, or if it is not adult, it may have some object which have the eye like structure and moving object. So typically they consider that their parents. Once a duckling has imprinted to its mother, the sight of the mother acts as a cue to trigger a suite of the several promoting behaviors, such as following the mother around and follow that object or the object that they consider the their parent. So this is the imprinting, but imprinting have a crucial time. So if at the time of the hatching no object is there, then they will not consider as their parents to anything. And sometimes it has been observed that the hatched animals they imprint the humans as their parents. Okay, so it is an interesting case of imprinting being used for good comes from the efforts to rehabilitate the endangered whooping crane by raising chicks in captivity. Biologists dress up in full whooping crane costume while caring for the young birds, ensuring that they don't imprint on humans but rather on the bird dummies. So they are a part of costume. So eventually they teach the birds to migrate using ultralight aircraft and preparing them for release into the world. So next is the conditioning behaviors. So conditioning behaviors are the result of associative learning. They think or they learn to associate the things from one another, so which takes two forms. One is the classical conditioning and second is the operant conditioning. So what is the classical conditioning? So in the classical conditioning, the response already associated with one stimulus and is associated with a second stimulus to which it had no previous connection. Okay, so the most famous example of classical conditioning is the Pavlov's dog, that connected two things. One is the ringing of bell and second thing is the food which it is consumes. Okay, so it associates the ringing of bell with the coming food. So it thinks that if the bell is ringing, then food will come and it starts salivate. So it is the classical conditioning. So in Pavlov's experiment, every time a dog was given food and another stimulus was provided alongside the unconditioned stimuli, so specifically a bell was rung at the same time the dog received food. So this ringing of the bell paired with food is an example of the conditioning stimulus. Okay, so a new stimulus delivered in parallel with the unconditioned stimulus. Over time, the dog learned to associate the ringing of a bell with food and to respond by drooling. So eventually they would respond with drool when the bell was rung, and even when the unconditioned stimulus, the food was absent, this new artificially formed stimulus response pair consists of a conditioned stimuli, the bell ringing, and the conditioned response drooling. Okay. So is the unconditional response drooling in response to food exactly identical to the conditioned response drooling in response to the bell? Not necessarily. Pavlov discovered that the saliva in the conditioned dog was actually different in comparison than the saliva of unconditioned dog. The second type of conditioning is the operant conditioning. And it is something different than the classical one in that it does not rely on an existing stimuli response pair. Instead, whereas an organism performs a behavior or an intermediate step to the way to the complete behavior. So it is given a reward or a punishment. So at first, the organism may perform a behavior. For example, pressing a lever purely by chance. Through reinforcement, the organism is induced to perform the behavior more or less frequently. So one prominent early investigator of operant conditioning was the psychologist B.F. Skinner, the innovator of the Skinner box. So Skinner put rats in box containing a lever that would dispense food when pushed by the rat. The rat would initially push the lever a few times by accident and would then begin to associate pushing the lever with getting the food. So over time, the rat would push the lever more and more frequently in order to obtain the food. So not all the Skinner's experiment involved pleasant treats. The bottom of the box consisted of the metal grid that could deliver an electric shock to the rat as the punishment. So when the rat got an electric shock each time, it performed a certain behavior and it quickly learned to stop performing the behavior. As these experiments show, both positive and negative reinforcement can be used to shape the organism's behavior in operant conditioning. Then next one is the learning and cognition. So humans and other primates and some non-primate animals are capable of sophisticated learning that does not fit under the heading of classical and operant conditioning. So one example is the problem solving in the chimpanzees. Okay, so the German scientist Kohler did some of the earliest studies on problem solving in chimpanzees. He found that the chimps were capable to abstract thought and could think their way through possible solutions to a puzzle. So envisioning the result of the solution even before they carried it out. For example, one experiment, Kohler hung a banana in the chimpanzee's cage too high for them to reach. So several boxes were also placed randomly on the floor, and faced with this dilemma, some of the chimps, after a few false starts and some frustration, stacked the boxes one on top of the other and climbed on top of them and got the banana. So this behavior suggested they could visualize the result of stacking the boxes before they actually carried out the action. Then this type of learning can be performed in or learned in by the rats, and other animals can be learned by these types of the associative learning. Okay, so this is the problem solving learning and learning in cognition. So that was all about the previous experience on the behavior. So hope you are satisfied with this little session, and this session is powered by Digital Version 2, Jyoti Vidyapeeth Women's University, Jaipur. Thank you.